turn this into a political thing by saying that I am coming out here to raise the Benghazi question so that I destroy the possibility of Hillary Clinton's running for the office or the presidency. That is bullshit. That is not my motive. My motive is to get to the American people that you're being stolen from. Our tax dollars are going down the drain. I'm not taking an issue. I'm not a radical. Call me what you want. But the point is, the reality of it is that this has been a slow coup.
The reality is openly giving Al-Qaeda heat-seeking missiles is too much for you, and you're not going to be part of it.
No, I'm not going to be part of it. I talked to a couple of C-130 pilots that are pissed off. They're still military. They can't talk like they're doing. They say, my God, you won't believe I just got refueled. Air-to-air refueling in order to get weapons from the direct commercial sales program to the Middle East and store them at a safe house in Jordan, a CIA safe house in Jordan, Pakistan. That broke out a little bit a few months ago, and the gatekeepers immediately squashed it. Also, back to Gary Hart. Gary Hart wrote a letter to the Senate Armed Services Committee and the Senate Intelligence Committee. He released all the maps. He released all the flight plan to Bill Holden, his security advisor. All of them went to the Senate Armed Services Committee and the Senate Intelligence Committee. He wrote a letter, sent it back to me. I posted it on the Internet. The last paragraph of that letter says they failed to investigate any of it because they had already known about it. It was a sanctioned operation. It was a secret operation run out of the White House. Our Senate and our Congress already knew about it, but they didn't tell the American people about it. And when Gary Hart wrote the letter asking for an investigation, because that was the only reason that I went to the man and said, hey, I want to get a congressional investigation into this because I'm running guns illegally to a southern front in violation of the Boland Amendment. What do I do, Mr. Senator? I've done exactly what me as an American citizen was supposed to do. I was supposed to contact my senator and sit down and expose an illegal operation. At that point in time, I was a government employee. According to federal law, it is my responsibility if I become aware of any illegal operation that involves taxpayer money. It is my obligation to put that to my supervisor or my community office.
That's right. Your phone's breaking up. But it is the law. You're supposed to report illegal stuff, but then they'll try to use some national security issue on you and now throw you in jail for 20 years, not five. And Obama has prosecuted more people with that than any other president before him. I want to go to some phone calls and skip this network break because this is so historical. You're hearing a major CIA contractor, one of the most famous ones ever, also with a deep cover Pentagon. He just gave the code name for that. And Tosh Plumlee, Robert Tosh Plumlee. Robert Tosh Plumlee is his Facebook. We have the information mirrored at Infowars.com. This is Infowars. And we saw the military by the thousands, including officers, holding up over their face in uniform last year, signs saying, I will not attack Syria for Al-Qaeda. And so I think they went too far trying to openly arm Al-Qaeda. And that's what Benghazi was all about. And so Tosh Plumlee is blowing it all wide open and explaining what it's really all about. Tosh, I want to go to phone calls here because we're only going to the bottom of the hour, and I appreciate your time. We're going to go to Lee and Sean and Gigi and Raymond and Carlos. So be ready, callers, with your question, with your phone ready. But before I go any further, just briefly, you can just prove the State Department knew and that Benghazi, with your sources and your questions, was part of this program, so they knew, and it wasn't really an embassy substation. That's come out from other military sources like Colonel Schaefer, and boy, they came down on him when he came on this show, and he had to kind of backtrack some. But expanding on that, what happened? Was it a rogue group stealing the weapons? Did the ambassador not go along with it? Were they planning a fake kidnapping as a new diversion hostage crisis for Obama? Because we know the Al-Qaeda force running the city of Benghazi was the hired State Department security. What are you being told really happened at Benghazi?
Okay, what started all this was a source of mine, a friend of mine, was transferred from the task force operating in Mexico to Afghanistan. And then it was attached to a NATO field command. In that process of NATO field command, it turned out about finding weapons, U.S. weapons being stashed at annex buildings and also in safe houses in Jordan and Pakistan. It was trying to leak out. Then when the weapons were stolen or pilfered, Then they started showing up, and not Syrian rebels, but in various different groups. Those these weapons started grenades, RPGs, launchers, grenade launchers. All this stuff started showing up in other hands. This is before, sort of before the rebels, you know, the, whatever you call the rebels, the Syrian rebels. But before we were even trying to arm them. So, and then here's the thing. This is what my source told me, and this is what motivated me. Ambassador Stevens found out about this. He made a complaint in writing back to the State Department, complaining about the weapons and how and why was these weapons getting into these people's hands. There's dispatches for that. There's more than one memo. State Department is sitting on those memos. Now, just recently, first State Department says, oh, no, he's full of crap. We don't have nothing like that. Same thing. They told him, oh, we don't have any documentation. And then after push for answers on this Benghazi thing, they finally come out with emails that shows that they actually knew every damn thing about those weapons, even to the extent of how those weapons were being infiltrated.
Well, let me stop you right there. Out of all the things I just threw out, that I brought that up to Colonel Schaefer weeks after it happened. He said, that's the word. It was a hit to take out Stevens. He got in a bunch of trouble, so he said, I'm just saying somebody, it was a planned hit. The point is, that's the best intel. We know the weapons were for Al-Qaeda. We know this, the ambassador from Turkey was there. They were supposed to ship them up there. We know Turkey's been the main conduit, along with Saudi Arabia. It's all confirmed. So they wanted to take Stevens out, because he was going to end up testifying to Congress. And then when the Navy SEALs didn't stand down, the sheep-dipped CIA former Navy SEALs came, and two of them held down the Al-Qaeda force for those 6-7 hours. That gave it time for the overhead drones to see what was happening, so the military found out there was a stand-down so Al-Qaeda could kill everybody at the base. And they tried to kill everybody else that fled, who got tipped off at checkpoints as well. But the whole thing, because it was badly managed, leaked out and blew up in Obama's face.
Well, that's about the size of it. My information came, coincides with that information. In other words, this has been vetted from many, many different sources. But at the time, when the Benghazi questions were arranged, they said they were all crazy. There was nothing to these questions, but yet they refused to answer them. I would just like to take one of those questions and ask direct POTUS. Have someone that has access to POTUS ask him just one of these questions. Get it on the record. What does he have to say about that question? Yes or no? Very simple answer. Yes or no? There's 11 questions posted up there. It's been all over the internet since September. Why are these people refused to answer those questions? Those questions are not that complicated. They're very simple. Now, Benghazi, we lost 4 good people because of our intelligence failure. That doesn't mean that we have a bad intelligence network. It means that we have gatekeepers that have infiltrated those networks, instigated by our own political structure. If I'm explaining,
and that basically makes the country blind in the end, having all these triple agents of corporate interest inside government. These people are the biggest threat.
That's it. In other words, this has been a slow coup. Like I say, it's been ongoing for years. This didn't happen overnight. In other words, we have been infiltrating people. Call them CIA, call them whatever. I say they're one group beyond CIA. In other words, I don't blame the CIA for all this. There's damn good people in the CIA, but they can't get past those gatekeepers. They can't get past those non-qualified gatekeepers that are put in those positions by the politics of the time, whether it be Bush era, Clinton era, or Obama era. Who is the man behind the curtain? Who's pulling the string? Who is in charge of this international gun-running operation? Is there an international gun-running operation ongoing today? All I'm asking is for the American people, get off their couch, go out, check out, research, investigate,
all right,
and come to your own conclusion.
Powerful, don't powerful insider knowledge. The secret of Benghazi released and confirmed here on air. We're risking our lives to bring you this information, especially Tosh. Pray for us. This isn't a game. Lee You're in Ontario, Canada. Thanks for holding her on the air.
Hi, Alex, Tosh. Okay, Alex, to me it looks like exactly what you were talking about yesterday with the gaslighting. This administration is so good at gaslighting all these scandals, and let's face it, they've had their own share of scandals, and gaslighting is something they've gotten really good at. Tosh, you've been around for, I think you were born in 1937, so you've been around through a few administrations. Seems like the people at the top, they never really change. The motives don't change. It seems like the American public now, I wouldn't know because I'm 28 years old, but it seems like generations, they have changed drastically while the people at the top haven't changed. What makes it in this generation? Do you think this generation, with all these scandals and the fact that we've really done nothing about them or don't seem too interested in it, do you think we have the capability of peacefully assembling and doing something about it?
Absolutely. Tosh, the same question. Yes. What do we do about it?
All right. Yeah. Okay. Yes, we do have the ability. That's the reason. In other words, it's time for if you want to call it rebel rousing or what the heck ever you call it, you've got to do something to motivate this younger generation, because the older generation has already contaminated this so bad that they themselves cannot untangle it. In other words, we are so indebted to some of these politicians that we have put in there, and their lobbyists and their cronies, and they're the ones that we've got to get rid of. Here's the problem. We've got a Congress and we've got a Senate that is totally contaminated with gatekeepers that we have put in position ourselves during these elections. I don't know if these elections are real or not. I'm not going to get off on theory. The point is this. Infiltration has started over the years and then migrated to where it is today. In other words, the people that are really for the Constitution and love their country and work for the government can't do their job, because when they find out something that could be derogatory against sitting POTUS, then they are not allowed.
That's right. So we need more people in the system and outside the system to speak out, have a moral revival. That's the answer. And Tosh Plumlee's leading it with his courage. Sean.
Get a march on D.C. like we did in the 60s. In other words, get everybody together that wants to save this Constitution. And I don't mean be radical, and I don't mean be a non-peaceful, and I don't mean going threatening, and I don't mean get a bunch of armed militia showing up pointing guns at everybody. That's not the way to do it. The way to do it is get a combined effort to make a march on Washington.
Sure. And support broadcasts that tell the truth and whistleblowers. All right, Sean in Pennsylvania, you're on the air. What's your question?
Hey, what's going on, guys? It's a pleasure to talk to you, Alex.
Man, these phones are too bad. I appreciate your call. And, you know, I just figured something out. When we take phone calls here, they're better. I'm going to go to our system. Genesis phone system is degrading. I know it had problems last week, and the callers have bad phones as well, but it is just unintelligible half the time. So if you hear a caller who you can't understand their phone, Genesis, they can't come on as a caller. Ramon in Florida.
Well, I'm getting spikes all over my phone here, so I don't know where that's coming
from. Oh, who knows? Go ahead. Ramon in Florida, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Am I intelligible, sir?
Yes, go ahead. Ask your question.
All right. First things first. You were involved in the Iran-Contra scandal, Mr. Plumlee, and obviously the black community was affected most by, you know, the crack epidemic and these situations. So I wanted to know your opinion on how can I get my people more involved and more, get them to understand better that this, all these problems affect all of us. It's not just a white thing. It's not just a Clive and Bundy thing. It's an everyone thing. We should all rally around one another when we see these situations happening where, you know, people are getting taken advantage of. And what's your opinion on how we can unite? Because the last caller touched on it, but my community is most affected by this because they don't have the knowledge. They haven't been taught all these situations like the Iran-Contra.
Now, that's a great question, Tosh. Don't Americans have to come together regardless of race, religion, or creed for freedom?
Yeah, definitely. That's one of the ways that they destroy the credibility of people that do the research and come forward. They play the race card against them. I'm sorry Mr. Bundy said the same that he said, you know, but there again, that's no reason to put the emphasis on race and then, you know, blah, 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 and forget what the real problem is. I'm not saying I condone what
No, I totally understand. They're diverting with little issues while the government's shipping in the narcotics and laundering it, and they're setting up checkpoints on the highway looking for drugs they shipped in. Tosh Plumlee, we're going to talk to you again very soon. God bless you. Folks, check out his Facebook.
We're on the march.